We have Maylei Blackwell, who will come to us and talk with us about her work with Indigenous women from Mexico. As the National Museum of the American Indian, our mission is hemispheric, and we wanted to make sure that we had voices from the South as well as voices from the North. So join me and there's my Maylei, I couldn't see her. Join me in welcoming Maylei Blackwell. She is an interdisciplinary scholar. She's an activist, an oral historian, and author. She is an associate professor in the Cesar Chavez Department of Chicana, Chicano Studies and Women's Studies Department, and affiliated faculty in the American Indian Studies and Lesbian, Gay, Bisexual, and Transgender Studies at the University of California, Los Angeles. Welcome, Maylei.
It's an incredible honor to be here with you all today with so many sheroes and amazing warrior women, with those who've paved the path for us to walk on, and those who are walking here with us right now, paving the path for those who come behind us, and they're right behind us, they're these younger women. So I want to share something with you called the practice of let's see if he pulls it up here. While he's doing that, I wanted to also dedicate this talk, the words that I have today, to Berta Cáceres, who was mentioned this morning, the Linca human rights activist and land rights activist who struggled against the hydro dams in her territory, and even despite threats against her life, continued to do that. And she was murdered earlier this month, a few weeks ago, in Honduras, and called attention to the coup that's happened there in Honduras and the kinds of danger it's created. So I think, several of the women mentioned earlier today about strong women, strong nations, and that indigenous pueblos, indigenous nations, we have an interrelationship with the security. Also, just I'm honored to be here among all these amazing women to also recognize the tradition that I was taught in and being taught by my mom to receive the stories of women in my family. And that by holding those threads of stories that have been fragmented by urbanization or alcohol and frayed by, losing our root, that even when we listen with our heart, that those threads can be reconnected and those stories become whole. So the first slide, you have to use your radical imagination here. I know that's how we create another world, right? So the first slide is by Major Ana Maria of the Zapatista National Liberation Army. And she says, "The mountain spoke to us of taking arms in order to have voice, spoke of covering our faces in order to be seen, spoke of forgetting our names in order to be named, spoke of guarding our past in order to have a present." And so what I want to share with you is about including our hemispheric perspectives and bringing those perspectives from all over. Abya Yala, with the Kuna people of Colombia and Panama, call Abya Yala our interconnectedness north and south. On January 1st, 1994, the Zapatista Army of National Liberation lodged an armed insurrection in Chiapas. And by armed, I mean like a few arms, but really just like sticks and stuff, which you could see a picture here with your radical imagination. And that day was important because it was the day the North American Free Trade Agreement was to go into effect. Amidst the armed uprising, a war of ideas and words was also launched. Apart from taking over the municipal buildings and destroying places that signified repression, like police stations, insurgents distributed a pamphlet called The Desperador Mexicano, or The Mexican Awakening, which made mention of the EZLN's revolutionary laws, including the revolutionary law of women. Many commentators mentioned that one of the greatest surprises of the Zapatista uprising was the presence of so many young women. In fact, 30% of the armed insurrection were women, and they led several leadership roles in this military attack. While little press attention was given to the women's revolutionary laws within the first few hours of the revolt, several of the Indigenous women leaders of the EZLN were those making statements to the press, including Captains Laura and Elisa, Major Ana Maria, and Comandante Ramona. Still using your imagination. Even in this early moment of the uprising, official state reaction embroiled the Chiapas conflict to a struggle over representation. It was first an effort to discredit the EZLN. The Mexican state official denied that the insurgency was legitimately or authentically indigenous by suggesting that indigenous revolts were spontaneous and lacked organization, and the fact that this happened on January 1st, you know, the night after a night of partying, and very early in the morning was proof that it couldn't be indigenous. And in an even more complicated turn, the struggle over authenticity and meaning took a gendered twist, and that's what I want to talk to you about today. So I want to talk to you about a gendered logic of racism that the Mexican state used and how Indigenous women's movement in Mexico got around that, how Indigenous women's rights basically were able to overcome those blockages by the state by enacting a practice of autonomy. And so in Mexico, autonomy is, it's not equivalent to sovereignty because it doesn't have the same federal system, but that's what it's called, you know, in Mexico. There's a slide, you could use this in your imagination. I have a slide that says how activists wove in between different scales of national, local, and transnational power. And then I want to conclude by sharing how Indigenous women organized within the diaspora. Okay, now I have to quickly show you all the slides that I just talked about and not trip. So this were the words of the Major Ana Maria. So the 1990s witnessed an emergence of a mass-based Indigenous rights movement throughout Mexico, but indeed throughout Latin America. So some of the largest movements even brought the changes in state power. In Mexico, the roots of many Indigenous struggles came to the surface. Am I supposed to use this? Okay. You can see what I talked about armed, right? Who's armed here? The EZLN and the women who are trying to keep the military out of their communities because this meant a heightened sexual violence and assault. These are the women who were responsible for creating the women's revolutionary law, which were the base communities, right? That it indeed wasn't feminist infiltrators. And this is what I wanted to talk to you about today, is these four ideas. So, women who had been in local movements before the Zapatista rebellion began to organize nationally. These were women who were in community radios. They were women who were in traditional governance structures with their brothers and their fathers. These were women who were in weavers' collectives, and they began to meet with each other and organize. And they came together in 1997 to form the National Network of Indigenous Women, or the CONAMI, which I'll refer to them as because that's their acronym in Spanish, the first national movement of Indigenous women in Mexico. Some were already established leaders, some were forced into leadership because some of the men in their communities were arrested, some were murdered, and others felt this shift in the winds that were beginning to happen, and they began to commit their lives to the fight against the obliteration of their peoples and the revitalization of Indigenous cultures. So since 1998, I've had the great privilege of being a Northern Native woman who accompanies Indigenous women's organizing in the South and worked with CONAMI. And they have been in a struggle for Indigenous autonomy based on Indigenous customary laws, which is in Spanish is called usos y costumbres, Indigenous jurisprudence and self-governance, while at the same time critiquing and transforming those policies in relationship to their own gendered understanding of power. So to give some context, Mexico has the largest Indigenous population in the hemisphere. Sometimes I think we forget that. With 63 different Indigenous pueblos. I don't usually translate the word pueblos. In our context, we would call them tribes or nations. But pueblos means the place you're from and also the people. So Indigenous people number over 25.5 million, constituting 21.5% of Mexico's population. So although they're not the majority population like in Guatemala or in Bolivia, Indigenous folks in Mexico are the largest population in the hemisphere. There's 11 million speakers of over 364 indigenous languages throughout the country. So even within these pueblos or tribes, as we would call them, there's multiple languages, right? And people diminish what they're called, right? They call them dialects, which isn't true because we don't call French a dialect of English, right? English, French, Italian, those are all different languages that we recognize as languages. So just to give you some of the legal, political, and economic landscape. Convention 169 of the ILO, of the United Nations, Mexico was the first country to sign that in 1991. It was kind of a surprise, and they reformed their constitution under Article 2 to recognize the so-called pluricultural nature of Mexico, so recognizing indigenous culture and rights, but not actually having any enforcement mechanisms. At the same moment of this new recognition of indigenous rights, Mexico was also entering into a free trade agreement with North America, with the U.S. and Canada, which meant dismantling the ejido system or the collective land tenure system. So it's interesting that in Mexico, indigenous rights as a movement emerges at the same time as the imposition of the neoliberal government structure. And by neoliberal, it just means this idea of free trade is privileged, their scaling back of state social services, there's the privatization of land. So while indigenous rights is being recognized, the land base and collective land tenure is being dismantled. So we know these policies, neoliberal policies, has been very detrimental for indigenous peoples in Mexico, from the flooding of the markets of GMO corn, right, kind of threatening the millennial corn cultures of Mexico, where there's thousands of varieties of corn, and leading to migration, right, where people don't, if they no longer have their land to farm and to live together on, then it pushes people into the migrant stream, which I'm going to end on today. So the first Zapatista uprising, what's really fascinating is that even Subcomandante Marcos, probably the most important or well-known spokesperson, and in some ways that's even a reflection of the racism of society, right? That people recognize a mestizo spokesperson as the leader, and in fact it is the clandestine revolutionary committee that leads the Zapatistas. But he has said that the first Zapatista uprising was not January 1st, 1994, but it was March 8th, International Women's Day, 1993, when the Zapatista Women's Law was passed. And yet racism reveals one of its contradictory or gendered logics in relationship to women's rights in indigenous cultures in Mexico. On the one hand, I began to tell you at the beginning, the government claimed that the Zapatista uprising was not truly indigenous and was led by outside agitators and feminist infiltrators because it was well organized and executed. It happened early in the morning, and women comprised 30% of the armed forces. And that their demands included women's right to equality, the right to live without violence, the right to equal pay, the right to choose one's partner, to decide how many children you would have. So since those were codified in the Women's Revolutionary Law, it was said that this wasn't an authentically indigenous uprising. Yet in contradiction of that argument, 10 years later, when the government was negotiating to pass the San Andres Peace Accords, which were the peace accords that were signed between the Mexican government and the Zapatista army, they argued that they were not going to pass the full scale of indigenous rights because indigenous cultures violated the rights of women within what's called usos y costumbres, or customary law. So you can see this kind of dual logic of racism, when the Mexican government probably is not the best defender on the planet of women's rights and suddenly is very interested in this, but also how in academies we call the idea that gender is becoming a discourse of governmentality. And that is how gender discourse is being cleaved away from indigenous rights as if they're not related, and of course they are, to regulate who is a good and bad subject, who can be worthy of rights and who cannot. So the denial of indigenous self-determination in both of these cases revolves around questions of gender. And it ignores the long history of Indigenous women's activism, right? Including women that I've interviewed, Margarita Gutierrez, a Nyanyu activist, who's pictured here, and who was part of one of two women who negotiated the San Andres Peace Accords, and who said that she had been an Indigenous rights activist before that time, so before 1994, but it was really sitting on that peace accords and helping women come to their voice in that process that really formed her as an Indigenous women's rights activist, one who was committed to women's rights within Indigenous culture. So much of the government's argument about Indigenous self-governance is based on their own static portrayal of Indigenous culture and their efforts to control that representation, right? And Ike showed you an older picture of this kind of static notion of how Indigenous women are portrayed. But it's also this discourse of modernity, right? Where Indigenous cultures are referred or seen as static, as backwards, and that non-modern cultures, and that modernity is really measured on ideas of gender, right? So somehow it's portrayed as if Indigenous cultures are somewhat more patriarchal than Mexican culture at large, right? And all this ignores all the activism that's been happening. And we've heard this earlier on the earlier panel, right? That defining Indigenous culture as uncivilized or not ready for rights in this example is being regulated by Western imposed notions of gender. And Lois Riesling gave us that idea when she was talking about the resurgence of a girl's ceremony. So I think it's important to listen to the voices of people like Margarita and also Tomas Sandoval. So Margarita's a Nyanyu activist, and people are reclaiming their names, right? So Nyanyu, it's historically known as Otami, but they say that's the government-imposed word for us, and we are the Nyanyu. Or other folks like Tomasa Sandoval, who at the second Congress of the CONAMI said that for women, for Indigenous autonomy, it's two, and women's rights and Indigenous rights are two sides of the same coin. And she's a Purépecha activist from Michoacán. And she says you can't not have a full autonomy for Indigenous people without women's rights. And of course, there's no women's rights without Indigenous autonomy, because Indigenous women will not be participating. So that's led to this idea of the practice of autonomy and how women in Mexico have gotten around this question, in part by taking what is largely a governmental rights discourse and translating it into their daily life. So the demand for autonomy is a larger framework comprised by the right to be a pueblo, or the right to be a people, the right to land and the protection of territory, the right to self-determination and autonomy, the right to cultural traditions and forms of political representation and jurisprudence, the right to protect and use the natural resources of their land. Indigenous women support all these claims, all these juridical, territorial, and cultural claims to autonomy. But what I've noticed working with them for almost 20 years is that they also have expanded the meaning of these claims. So Indigenous autonomy, by working through what I'm showing you here is a picture of this wonderful activist, Marichui, who, you know, they'll get out a butcher paper and they're like, which rights do we like? What part of the culture works for us? And they've expanded Indigenous autonomy to include bodily autonomy, right? The right not to be raped, the right to control how many children you have, to women's economic and political autonomy, right? So there's been a long process of grassroots consultation that's expanded the framework of autonomy beyond rights discourse. So even if the government hasn't recognized the full San Andres Peace Accords and they passed a very watered-down bill in 2001, Indigenous women have created a daily lived practice of autonomy. And one of the ways that I saw this reflected was in the second national gathering in Chilpancingo, Guerrero, that I attended. And if you listen to how they describe it, you'll hear. They say, we believe that autonomy for our pueblos, for our people, includes all areas of our lives, the home, the family, the community, the region. And that has to do with the respect and recognition of our culture, our territories, and our traditional medicine. For us, autonomy means parity, democracy, and equity between men and women, Indigenous and non-Indigenous, between all human beings, and above all, our rights as original peoples. So it's interesting for me to think about how they've expanded rights to be not just the rights the government can grant you, right? So they've taken autonomy away from the government and they've located it in the practices of their daily lives, how they relate to nature, how you relate to the cosmos, how you relate to people between you and in communities. And so in this sense, it's been a really important part of Indigenous revitalization in Mexico and been an important debate about usos y costumbres, or customary laws. And this has been not always received totally well by some of the brothers in the movement, you know, who are like, wait a minute, you're taking this to me, what? And so I think another strategy that's been really important that I've seen in the CONAMI has been weaving in between local, national, and transnational or international scales of power. And this has been really fascinating to watch women who are probably the most marginalized sector of Mexican society. When they're blocked at the national movement, so if they've created this new form of autonomy and the guys in the two national indigenous organizations are like, we're not sure about that, they move to the continental scale, and their members such as Margarita and Martha Sanchez and Sofia Robles helped to found the Continental Network of Indigenous Women, who just celebrated their 20th anniversary in Guatemala last fall. And that was an important network continentally. So the Continental Network of Indigenous Women of Abya-Yala. So they're using ideas of the interconnection of all the peoples of the hemisphere to work together to intervene in the UN DRIP process, right, to intervene. Actually, they formed in protest of the way they were excluded for the Fourth World Conference on Women in Beijing. So they're an interesting formation because they are intervening both with their mestizo counterparts in Latin America, but also within training women and helping them be able to access the international system. But it's not just that they are using the international system, they're also using the international system to transform national law, or they're bringing the national movement home to their communities. So what I've really seen is that localization. Oaxaca, the state of Oaxaca in Mexico, has 418 out of the 510 municipalities in Oaxaca are indigenous municipalities, meaning that they're run through usos y costumbres, right? They're run through customary law. And so what I've seen, I have just the greatest privilege of meeting these women 20 years ago. Some were, you know, were in their 20s like I was, and now some are older. Some were moms and grandmas then, and now are elders in their community. And one such elder is Sofia Robles, a Zapotec woman, who translated all these ideas back into her community. And she's a Zapotec woman who lives in the Mije district of Oaxaca, and she recently became the municipal president of the Mije district, and as well founded one of the regional Mije women's networks, right? So by not just relying on the state or the UN system, but by moving in between these different scales of power, they've really been able to launch important forms of consciousness and rights and identities. And the last thing I want to share with you today, this is that the scales has been so important to my thinking when watching them do this that it's informing how I'm writing the book that I'm finally writing up on all this work with them, following each scale, the national, the transnational, how they're localizing that, and then within the diaspora. That's what I want to talk to you a little bit about today. Because I've been talking about the largest hemispheric population of indigenous peoples, but that population isn't just in Mexico, that it's also part of a diaspora within the United States. So I want to wrap up by talking about that Latin American indigenous diaspora in my hometown, Los Angeles. It's probably an underestimation, but folks are estimating there's about 120,000 Zapotecs, Oaxacan indigenous migrants, living in Los Angeles right now. And while there's, you know, there's an American Indian you know, service sector, and there's a Latino service sector, both those service sectors are failing this population by and large, because when people get here, they're not Spanish speakers and they're not English speakers. They're Zapotec or Mixtec speakers. There's also a considerable population of Mayan, in the Mayan diaspora in Los Angeles and in San Francisco. And this has led to new forms of Indigenous consciousness, which has been really fascinating, is that I worked on this research for a long time in the 90s and early 2000s, but about 2006, the women leaders of the Binational Indigenous Front, the FIOB, approached me, and they wanted to start a women's leadership development. They wanted to be able to access decision-making in their community, and so they designed this program called Miel, which is honey in Spanish. The women and Indigenous women in leadership is what it means. And they've been at the forefront of stopping bullying, right? Because they're working with several systems of colonial power, so not just how they're interacting with a U.S. racial system, but how a racial system of anti-Indigenous prejudice is being migrated from Mexico. So there's been a lot of bullying within schools of Indigenous kids by mestizo kids, mestizo Mexican kids. And so they're really working out all these important campaigns, like in Oxnard, they joined the school board. I mean, people who are accessing the school board to learn how to get the bullying stopped of their family. We've been meeting in community meetings. They're part of reproducing their tradition. So some of the pueblos in Oaxaca have more people in Los Angeles than they do in their pueblos. But the second generation and third generation, I'm really honored to say I get to mentor even Zapotec and Mayan doctoral students who are doing amazing work in this area. That those kids, when they learn their traditional dances, go to Oaxaca to perform them first and then come home. So we see some things that are similar to how Pan and Indian identities happened after relocation and in urban spaces. But I think there's a whole different process going on. And part of that process is what I'm trying to bring out in a mapping project I co-direct with Mashana Goman and Wendy Teeter at UCLA. It's Mapping Indigenous Los Angeles, mila.ss.ucla.edu if you're interested. What's really fascinating is that it's a digital storytelling project where we use people's storytelling, their histories of place, to map them on the map. And then within each region, each one you can click on it. So we just finished the Latin American Indigenous Diaspora map. And that's part of the way that we're trying to help different layers of Indigenous communities in LA relate to each other and hear each other. Because numerically, this is a very large community, but they're on the homelands of the Tongva people, of Gabrieleños. Right, so what does it mean to be running Mayan daykeeper ceremonies in the homelands of other peoples? So we're using the map to try to educate the different layers of Indigenous LA, the relocated American Indian folks, the folks of Native California who are largely unrecognized except for a few tribes that aren't in the county, the Pacific Islander diaspora, the Chamorro, folks who have done a canoeing map with Native Californians, and then this Latin American Indigenous diaspora. So we're using this because oftentimes Indigenous people are folded into other racial groups, right? When people look at this group, it's like you know, Mexican is a Mexican is a Mexican, but it's not true. What's being hidden there is these rich Indigenous cultures. What's being hidden within Asian Americans often is Pacific Islanders, right? So we're trying to reveal that that Los Angeles is what Renya Ramirez calls a transnational hub for Indigenous cultures. And with that, I'll stop and thank you very much for your attention and time.
Thank you, Maylei. And just as we look forward to seeing Joy's play in full production, I look forward to seeing and being able to read Maylei's new book, called Scales of Resistance, Indigenous Women and the Practice of Autonomy, which I believe will just further develop the ideas that she started here.